This is your life. This, the New London Theatre. And in a moment, I hope this stage will be filled with some of the most fascinating people it's been my fortune to meet. Right now, we're counting down the seconds to what I hope will be the climax of months of careful planning and thousands of miles of travelling to bring you a real cracker of a Christmas story. A story about someone who has been, not without justification, described as the most famous man on earth. Someone whose story has reached a milestone quite recently, a historic milestone, which is why he believes he's coming to a television studio to give an interview about it. Not to me, and not in front of an audience. But whatever happens next, I promise you, it's the most unpredictable Christmas I remember. Hello, champ, and a very special welcome to the second favorite city of London. For what I can say, the three-time champion of the world, tonight's Muhammad Ali, this is your life. Come on down the stairs, just go under the man. We've got some lovely surprises for you. Very promising. Really gorgeous. I must say a very special thank you to your pal and mine, boxing commentator Reg Guttridge, for bringing you along here.
He lied to me. I want to say one thing. I watched this show for years in the States, and I wondered why was everybody so anxious to get me here, this is terrible.
This is the right time to get you. Muhammad Ali, this is your life, and there could be no more appropriate time for me to say that as we reach the end of a year which has seen you fight your way into history by becoming the first man to win the World Heavyweight Championship three times over. You have fought in a total of 59 professional matches the world over, but for our next surprise, Muhammad, I want to remind you of a match which showed you a very uncharacteristic side.
I didn't know at the time, but later you told me you were scared of me.
Of course, your wife, Veronica. Veronica, how did you find out he was scared of you?
Well, we met when he was in Salt Lake City doing an exhibition. And when I met him, he didn't say anything. And usually he grabs and hugs people like he still does now. But later when I got to know him, he told me that that's why he wouldn't say anything, because he was afraid.
Well, it's not easy to contemplate a speechless Muhammad Ali, beautiful. Because the fact that you're...
Beautiful women just frighten most men.
The fact that you're as mercurial with your words as you are with your fists has made you one of the world's greatest box office stars. And if you look at that screen, we're going over 5,500 miles now to a city you know well, the bright lights of Las Vegas, where no star is shining quite so brightly as the one about to speak to you now, from his dressing room at the world-famous Caesar's Palace, your old pal, Britain's own Tom Jones.
Hello, Eamon. I must say I admire your guts for springing a surprise like this on Muhammad Ali. Muhammad, I wonder if the surprise is as big as the one you got from Henry Cooper's left hand in 1963. Putting all jokes aside, I'm sitting here in Las Vegas in the dressing room between shows, and as you know, anybody can pop in from time to time, like the time, I think it was about 10 years ago, in the Latin Casino in Cherry Hill, New Jersey. Knock him at the door, I looked up, and you were standing there. And we've been friends ever since. We've had a chance to talk together from time to time. I must admit, I like this the setup tonight, because I can talk to you and you can't interrupt me. You know, boxing is the only sport that I really like. I've always enjoyed boxing, and I don't think anybody would argue with me that that you are the greatest boxer of all time. Not only a boxer, I think one of the greatest entertainers. But speaking of entertainers, I remember the time when you recorded, you made a record, I should say, of a song called Stand By Me. Well, I would just like to say this. I won't go into boxing if you stay away from singing. You know, this is a switch. I'm over here in Las Vegas, you are in London, and I hope you're having a great time in my country. The only thing is, I wish I was there to enjoy it with you. But I'll see you soon. Oh, and by the way, be gentle with Eamon.
Thank you, Tom Jones, and nice to know you care. Well, Muhammad Ali, this is your life, and you were...
I still don't believe this.
You were born here at the General Hospital in Louisville, Kentucky, at 6:35 p.m. precisely on January the 17th, 1942, tipping the scales at 6 pounds, 7 ounces. Your father's a sign writer, and you're named after him, Cassius Marcellus Clay. Family home is here at 1121 West Oak Street. And it's there one day when you're only 18 months old, you show the first indication of things to come. You're swinging your arms as babies do.
And that's when my baby boy's left hand knocked my front tooth right out.
From Louisville, to surprise you, who else but your mother, Mrs. Odessa Clay, and your father,
Patrick.
Odessa, how did you come?
Where did you get
here?
Don't answer any questions.
Okay.
You tell me how you came to be the champ's first victim.
Well, Ollie was always a large baby, and when he was a few months old, he looked like a miniature boxer. And when he was 18 months old, he was very strong and had big muscular arms. So one day he was swinging his arms like babies will do. I wasn't looking, and he hit me in the mouth and knocked a tooth out. And later I had to go to a dentist because it had loosened my other tooth.
Cassius, I know his nickname for you is Cash, but what does he call his mother?
Bird.
Bird. Odessa, where does he get the bird from?
Well, Ollie.
Him.
No, Ollie used to always tell me, say, you have a small nose, just like a bird.
Well, today, Muhammad, you must be one of the most photographed men in the world. But thanks to your mother, we can show a rare picture of the future world champ, aged just 2 and a half. Sitting next to your baby brother, who's 18 months younger.
And looking at that picture, you can recognize that we have beautiful parents.
We've flown in from his home in Chicago, your brother, Rahman Ali.
Oh, man. Man.
Now, being so close as you are in age, you've been great pals since you were kids, eh?
That's right. We always have did things together in life, and Muhammad always predicted from a small boy that he would be the world's heavyweight champion. And I want to exclusively bring that out because he always said, told the kids in the neighborhood, I'm going to be champ of the world, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. There were a few of them laughed at Muhammad, but he always had the strong mind, the determination to do it, to stick by his word. And
down.
He did it.
Tell us about hide and seek before you sit down.
In front of the world, I love him with all my heart. He's a beautiful people.
All right. Thank you, Robin. Well, Muhammad, I know that hometown of yours has a great place in your affections.
All pay all the plane fares?
Yes, but we also hit the road to Louisville, if you look. And we went down Dixie Highway, to be exact, to a place where you were a regular customer as a youngster. Waddell's Barbershop, where your favorite barber is still at work.
Hi, Gigi.
And the barber is, of course, your father's eldest sister, your Aunt Eva.
Hi, Muhammad. Let me explain why they call you Gigi. When I changed your diapers, all you could say was Gigi. Later on, you said Gigi meant golden gloves. I became a barber because I had 8 brothers' hair to cut. So I had plenty of experience. Now when you come into the barbershop, all you do is stop the traffic. Hey, Muhammad, you'll never guess whose hair I've been cutting. Jimmy Ellis.
Hi, Mom. You know, we go back a long time. You know, we had our ups and downs together, man. You know, we slept side by side, fought side by side. You have everything, a lot of personal things. And I want to say thanks, man. You've been just like a brother to me.
Another satisfied customer. Next.
And in a Louisville cloudburst, that hometown pal of yours showed us how, as a kid, you used to race the school bus to keep training. Now, incredible to think that one day you, too, would fight each other for the world championship, a fight you won, but let's catch up with Jimmy Ellis now at his destination.
Hey, Muhammad. It's a school teacher from way back. This is Carter.
Oh, hello, Muhammad. You remember your old school, Virginia Avenue School?
Too.
Why don't you come here?
I remember you.
Muhammad. It was in this very room that I taught you when you were 8 years old.
She's
in the third grade. And you sat in this seat where Don Tavis is sitting now. He is somewhat like you. I remember when you were at that age. I reprimanded you one day because you didn't follow directions. And when I reprimanded you, your classmates answered, "Miss Carter, did you ever see him fight?" And then I answered, "Fight? Who has ever done anything with fighting?" But now I laugh about that, because since I've left the classroom, I've directed the YWCA, and I sent for you to make a speech. You not only made the speech, you brought me $10,000 for the drive and wrote the check right there. Now many boys and girls are happy because of the $10,000 that you gave. So fighting did do something for you. Muhammad, the kids have a message for you.
You are
great! You are the greatest. And that's the truth. Mrs. Carter and me, it's going to join your Aunt Eva and leaving their car over there.
And boy, are you in for a shock. From Louisville Airport, they flew right here to London. No. Your Aunt Eva. No. Your former schoolmistress, Mrs. Gladys Carter.
Miss Carter.
And just a little prior, your old pal, Jimmy Ellis. Aunt Eva, did you bring your scissors?
Sure. And it looks like he needs a haircut right now.
I can't believe this.
Well, now, Muhammad, as we've just seen, when it rains in Louisville, it pulls no punches.
I didn't know you all could last so much. Come on.
Well, it was on a rainy day. Your boxing career started. You were 12 years old, and Cash, you just bought him a new bicycle, didn't you, for Christmas?
That's right. A red bike. With chrome finish and white wall tires. He had got on it starting at home and it had begun to rain. So he headed for the local bazaar, where they were.
Just don't talk too long, because I got time to. I got my talk from him. See if he is stuck.
Well, I want to hear about this.
It was being held indoor at Columbia Auditorium, where he had found some free.
Don't go too long.
Candy. Boy. And popcorn.
Long
okay, so you look for your free candy and popcorn, okay. And you park your gleaming new bicycle at the door of the auditorium. But when the popcorn and the candy are finished, Muhammad, it's time to go home.
That's when my talk has started, so I know it.
What happened when you go to collect that bike, the pride of your young life?
Huh?
Where was your bike?
I couldn't find it.
You couldn't find it, that's right. It was stolen.
You don't have my bike here.
No. You did report the theft to a policeman.
Joe Martin, he's not here either.
Well, I know that you when you tell that policeman what you're going to do to whoever stole that treasured Christmas gift from your father.
You said I'm going to whip him. And I said before that you better learn to fight.
Oh, that's
yes, that same policeman that's from 24 years ago. Now retired Louisville police officer, Joe Martin.
And also from Louisville,
your
great friend and
boy,
his brother, Red
Stoner. Well, now, Joe, he'd come to the right man to complain about his bike, yes, because in your spare time, you ran a boxing gym in those days.
That's true, and he was very enthused about boxing at that time, and I had a show on television every week, amateur boxing, Tomorrow's Champion. And it wasn't but a short time I put him on that show, and that was his first boxing match was on television. And
Lloyd tell you something
funny. There you are, Muhammad. I have a picture of you.
No, what?
It's when you made you stepped in front of the cameras for the first time. Why what are you going to tell
that?
Me?
Why'd you show that picture? No, he had a boxing show, and he was a trainer, too. It was in those days, integration hadn't taken place, and black people didn't quite have the opportunity they got now. So he had the championship show, and he trained fighters more physically than he did. And I would always train at 6 o'clock at his gym and sneak his gym at 8 o'clock to really learn about boxing. And then, because in the Golden Gloves, a lot of his boys would beat his boys, and I thought he was the better trainer, so I would sneak down and learn how to do it. He taught me the jabs, he taught me hooks, and both of them together made me who I am today.
Fred, tell me.
So since you surprised me, I must tell you the surprise. I never told you this, but I always sneaked his gym. Well, see, because he had the complexion and the connection to get the protection.
Brad Stoner, if he let you get a word in edgeways, would you tell me why is it you think the champ here has managed to keep his boyhood good looks?
Well, in the early parts of his training, we concentrated on teaching him how to not stand still and be hit, to keep moving in and out and to right and left. And, look at him. It's paid off. And he's still a prick.
But tell me now, tell me, Joe, Ali was asking me, you didn't by any chance find the bicycle, did you?
I can't believe it.
Never have found it yet, but we will eventually.
Thank you very much, Joe Martin and Fred Stoner.
This is a show.
Well, as Joe Martin has told us, your first ever match in a boxing ring was on that television show, Tomorrow's Champions, and we set out to find the first person in the world who came out fighting at that first bell against the future world champion.
No.
Today, he works on the production line here at the Ford plant just outside Louisville. And of all the millions of words written and spoken about your opponents, we were amazed to find no one had ever before asked your very first opponent memory of that day 24 years ago, but he recalls it now. As you said, you remembered his name, Ronnie O'Keefe.
Hello, Muhammad.
Is that him?
Remember that day I first stepped in the ring with you?
Got
it was your first fight. First fight. And also happened to be my last fight. You were 12 years old. You weighed 88 pounds. I was 14. And I weighed one pound less. We went 3 rounds. You won by a split decision. But I like to tell my co-workers here, that makes me better than Norton or Foreman and all the rest. You put them to sleep. It woke me up to the fact that in the fight game, I'd never be in the same league with you. But I have no regrets. I just figure I'm a better lover than a fighter. Everybody's gone here, so I think I'd do the same. See you, champ.
And see we will to shake your hand again for the first time in 24 years.
No.
We've flown him tonight.
He's here.
Ronnie. Okay.
Oh, man.
Thank you.
Boy, hard time fly. We done got old. He don't look none less like he used to.
Jimmy Ellis, you and Muhammad were matched on that
first night.
Tomorrow's Champions program. Well, I don't know if Muhammad remembers it, but
he
you do.
First fight. That made you famous too, didn't it? You the first man to fought Muhammad Ali. Ain't that something? Okay.
Thank you, sir. We were just talking, Jimmy and I, actually, about that program, Tomorrow's Champions. And the two of you were matched for a purse of $4 each, Jimmy, but the fight never took place. Why was that?
Oh, because at that time, I didn't weigh enough. And so he came over to me and said, man, we just lost $4 because you're too skinny. I said, no, we just lost $4 because you're too fit.
Well done. Well, constant training and sheer determination to be the best
put
you high in the amateur championships as a teenager, winning 6 Kentucky Golden Gloves championships and 2 National Golden Gloves finals. And one day, nearly 20 years ago, you read in the newspapers that one of America's top fight trainers is visiting Louisville. When high school's over for the day, age just 17, you dash to the hotel where he's staying and telephone his room from the lobby.
And you said, I got to talk to you on account of going to be the next heavyweight champion of the world.
Today, his name's inseparable from yours, that legendary figure of the fight game, your trainer and great friend. We've flown him from Miami, Angelo Dundee.
Hello, Angelo.
How are you doing?
This is your man's around. Look at all this, man.
Angelo, what did you do when you got that call?
Well, I tell you, he came on like gangbusters.
Just what I said.
He said, my name is Cassius Marcellus Clay Jr. I'm the Golden Glove champion of Louisville, Kentucky. I won the Pan American Games. I'm going to be Olympic champion. I'm pretty. And I want to talk to you.
All times, right?
Right. So he come up and, what else could I do? The TV program stunk. So he came up and I started talking to him. But I tell you, it's been a great feeling to be with this guy, because it's a misconception of Muhammad. Everybody says, my God, he must be tough to get along with. Easiest fighter I ever trained. Never had a problem. We never had one argument. It's dynamite. And it's been this way from the beginning. And let me tell you something. It's a great, great feeling to be, you know, be involved with a living legend like you, Muhammad. And I mean that sincerely, because you are the greatest. Also, one thing else. Every time a fighter would come up in the gymnasium, you would bust down that room door. You'd bust it down 12 times to try to psych out a guy. Do me a favor, buy me a door for Christmas.
Thank you, Angelo Dundee. Well, just a year after that first meeting with Angelo, you're just 18 when your victory in the National Golden Gloves Finals at Madison Square Garden follows onto the selection to represent the USA at the 1960 Olympic Games in Rome. But Joe Martin, what's this we hear about him being getting scared?
He was very scared of airplanes. He and I had kind of a wild ride in one of them, and he told me that he wasn't going to Rome unless I could get him on a boat. And I said, there's no way. You're going to have to fly. So he and I went out to Central Park and sat on the bench for about 2 hours and talked to him about it, and I was convinced that he would be Olympic champion, and I also told him, I said, I think you can be world champion sometime, but you've got to go through the Olympics. You've got to have that exposure.
Well, he did, and your international boxing career takes off on August 1960 when you step in the ring for the final battle for the gold medal. Your opponent is Poland's Zbigniew Piotrkowski.
He didn't go to Poland.
And I was lucky enough to be the commentator.
Oh, well, what a boxer this Clay is. For 18 years of age, the size of him, we're going to hear a lot more of this young man, I'd say.
Well, I reckon I've made worse predictions, in fact. The world hasn't stopped hearing about you ever since that Olympic victory.
He's not here.
Which significantly affected the rest of your life.
No.
Well, it's 18 years ago, isn't it?
He's not here.
Have you ever seen him since?
You didn't go to Poland, no.
Have you ever seen him since?
No, you can get these.
I'll tell you what he's doing. He's passing on the kind of experience he learned the hard way fighting you, because he's now one of Poland's national boxing coaches.
No. He was
and we've heart. Flown He's him like from he his home near Krakow, Ziggy Pietrzykowski.
No, man! No, man! You see me? No kidding. Man, come on, show me jazz. Show me jazz.
Thank you, Ziggy.
He speaks English, too, a little bit. Is that, oh, man, this is really a surprise.
Can I go on? Well, back home in Louisville, a group of businessmen get together to sponsor you as a professional fighter, and with some of the proceeds of that deal, you buy yourself your first car, a glistening Cadillac. And one day, soon after your triumphant return from Rome, you're to visit a local children's hospital in Louisville with another Olympic gold medalist who flies in from Nashville. And proudly, you drive your new car to collect the visitor.
But what I'll never forget is the great big sign he hung around the car.
To this day, a great family friend, she won 3 gold medals as a sprinter in Rome. We've flown her from Nashville, Wilma Rudolph.
Oh, this is a show.
Wilma.
Ain't she pretty? Look at Wilma.
Wilma, what was that huge sign he'd hung around his Cadillac?
Well, the huge sign was Olympic champion. And we drove around Louisville, Kentucky, and on the car was Wilma Rudolph and Cassius Clay, and he was yelling out the window, "We're the Olympic champions." But I think it was all just show, you know. I agree with Veronica. He's quite bashful.
How do you know?
Did you know him well since, and what else he does besides the sporting game?
After he's been at the top for so long, I would really like to commend you for all the wonderful work you've done with underprivileged children. And I have worked with you, and I'd like to say to you, thank you.
Thank you, Wilma Rudolph. Well,
this ain't real.
Just 4 years after turning professional, you fulfilled the...
I want to say one thing.
Yes, sir.
I had a lot of money. I've had many surprises. I'm at the stage now where it's hard to surprise me, to show me anything, to excite me, because I haven't had it all. I feel like a little bitty boy now just getting a new toy for Christmas. This is the only thing that could really shock me, something like this.
Well, let me just go on and tell you that youthful prophecy you gave Angelo Dundee there in that Louisville hotel room nearly 20 years ago, you fulfill it, of course. The date, February the 25th, 1964, and this is how you took the world heavyweight crown from the reigning champion, the late Sonny Liston.
Liston seems bewildered. He's unable to cope with Clay's sharpshooting. The champion has taken a terrible head beating from this marvelous young boxing master. Liston moves very wearily to his corner. Pandemonium has broken loose. Sonny Liston has not come out for round 7. He's got a new champion, Cassius Clay.
Well, Muhammad, that inimitable style of yours has challenged the descriptive talents of writers and commentators the world over. But a phrase you'll always be remembered by came from an unexpected source.
I still say it to this day, champ. He floats like a butterfly and he stings like a bee.
He's been in your corner for 14 years and 44 fights, floating in from New York, Drew Bundini Brown.
Oh, you bought it. I never saw him so dressed in my life. And he's sober.
Drew Bundini, what was the moment that inspired that phrase that became so famous that it even became a song?
Well, because to love God is to love people, and I must love Mohammed because he loves God. And all great fighters had nicknames like the Brown Bomber, Joe Louis, Rocky Marciano, The Rock, Sugar Ray Robinson, Sugar, Smoking Joe Frazier. And he was doing road work, and I was talking to God as I do, not with my mouth, but with my mind. And I was asking God, what was his nickname? And the feeling came to me, call him the way it is. float like a butterfly and sting like a bee.
But Bandini, you made a mistake, didn't you, when the champion first interviewed you for a job in his corner?
Yes, I call him a phony because I was with the great Sugar Ray Robinson for 7 years, and I never heard of anyone in sports or anything predicting anything but God saying when it's going to do, the weather or anything like that. And he said that he called the rounds. So I said he was a phony. But then he said to me, he got up off the couch and he looked me dead in the eyes. He said, I work hard and I train and I pray hard. And then that's fall, Bandini, and I knew he was human.
Thank you, Drew Bandini Brown.
Thank you.
Well, my average, you've a lot of tactical secrets for inside the ring, but outside the ring, we didn't know you had a secret call sign.
It goes like this.
He was best man at your wedding. You were best man at his. We flew him from his Vegas Hollywood flight for Howard Bingham. Howard, what's this?
It's like this, Akima.
It's like if we're in a large room and he's on one side and I'm on another. He won't phone out and say, "Hey, Bingham!" He'll say, and then I look. And
if he's and home and his wife is,
looking at the foxes,
I will sneak him out of the house and know his wife's to know I'm calling.
looking at the ladies also, he said,
"Fox, oh, thank you, and shut up, Howard Bingham.
Come on, man.
Well, in 1966, you traveled to London to defend your world championship against the reigning British and European champion, who'd given you something to remember him by in your first meeting in 1963, as Tom Jones mentioned earlier. Now you meet again at Highbury, London, 3 years later on May the 21st. And there was no chance of his missing this rematch tonight. Britain's own former champion, Henry Cooper.
No.
Henry, I know that to this day he does look good. You have a great respect for Muhammad Ali.
Oh, great respect. I mean, what more can you say about the man? He's done everything. A great natural athlete. But let's be honest, if he'd have gone whatever game you'd have gone in, I think he'd have been the top. The fastest moving heavyweight, I think, in the world today, ever likely to be in the future. He was grease lightning on two legs. I had all my work cut out trying to keep up with him and trying to land a punch on him, but a great guy.
You landed one, too.
One of the greatest. One of the greatest.
You hit me so hard. I never told you this. Well, I'm retired, he retired. Oh. You hit me so hard, you jarred my kin folks in Africa.
To be honest, have a look at him. He's not a bad-looking fellow as well, is he? Can't be bad.
You don't look so bad yourself.
Thank you, Henry Cooper. The night after that fight, I had the pleasure of talking to you on another show where my other guests included Dudley Moore and the late Sir Noel Coward, who found out you packed a conversational punch, too. By then, you'd become a member of the Islamic faith, and of course, it changed your name, and it made it clear you were no longer to be called Cassius Clay. Then this happened. Well, let's have a word about the fight last night, Cassius.
Muhammad,
I'm sorry. I didn't do that to you. Before.
Is that me? That's you, we both.
I'm glad he smiled when he said that.
You know my name, boy.
Don't worry, I'll get off here, boy.
You remember that?
Yeah, I almost hit you that day.
Well, a year later, Muhammad Ali begins a 3-year exile from boxing when he refuses on religious grounds to join the army, at that time engaged in the war in Vietnam. Even at the threat of a 5-year jail sentence does not deter him. Now, that was reversed in 1970 and his boxing license reinstated. Yeah. So after 3.5 years of legal and political punch and counterpunch, your exile from the ring is over. October 26th, the place Atlanta, Georgia. And world headlines proclaim that Muhammad Ali is back in action as you fight your way back to the title you'd set your heart on as a youngster.
Yelling Curry is hurt, and Ali is asking the referee to stop the bout. Ali puts a jab on the mouth, and right up the cut to the jaw. Curry is staggered, and the fight is over. Anderson goes into a front, takes the left hand high on the head. Ali drives the right over the head, drives the right to the head. A left on the chin, thrown by Muhammad Ali, and raising right to the jaw. A left and a right to the head. Bob Foster, the light heavyweight champion. Ali feigns being hurt, puts a jab on the mouth. Foster sticks out a jab, takes a blazing right, a left up and takes the jaw. Foster is down and takes the out. Ali is finding Joe Bugner is a tough customer. Bugner back to the rope, both hands to the head by Ali. Bugner hooks the left that goes over the head, drives Ali into the ropes and holds him there. Norton moves into Ali, driving both hands to the body, and the referee gets him out of a clinch. At long range, Norton takes the left hand, puts the jab.
And, of course, you went into the record books on September the 15th this year by beating Leon Spinks to become, as I said, the only man to win the world heavyweight title 3 times. Now, instead of resting, you go straight into making the film Freedom Road. Muhammad Ali, actor, playing the part of a former slave who becomes America's first black senator. But on the subject of acting, if you look at that screen, an international film star friend of yours recalls a film you made with him in 1962, Requiem for a Heavyweight, and remembers stepping into the ring with you for a fight sequence in that film. From Hollywood now, Anthony Quinn.
Young man, I want to say that to me, you're one of the greatest athletes that's ever lived. But now I understand that you're coming into my field. Now, I want to warn you, and you be careful. Last time you knocked me out in 8 rounds. This time, I'm going to go the full 15 with you, okay? I wish I were there with you tonight. You deserve everything and all the kudos that are thrown at you. You're one of the greatest, really.
Thank you, Anthony Quinn. Well, champ, not many people have gone the full 15 rounds with you, but before we close, I'd like to remind you of someone who has. Just as he promised he would one August day in 1970, during your exile from the ring, when he gave you a lift in a car from Philadelphia to New York, and when he pulls up on 42nd Street, a crowd starts to gather.
And I said, hey, man, you better get out of my car.
Not Joe
people
Frazier.
People might think you and I are good pals.
No,
you've described him as the fighter you most admire, your old adversary. We've flown him from Philadelphia.
Not Joe Frazier.
Smoking Joey. Joe, how did you come to be giving Muhammad Ali a lift in your car?
Well, number one, I had a chance to move around in Philadelphia, and I went to one of the hotels, and I promised to give him a ride to New York City that day. I got out the car. Somebody says, hey, go Smoking Joe Frazier. Oh, man, and he went off. Smoking Joe Frazier? Where is he? I want Smoking Joe Frazier. He got my title. So I went over and I shook his hand.
Crazy.
He told me, he says, listen, sir, I have a man who's doing a book on me. Would you interview him into New York City? We rode into New York City. This guy would not let me get one word in. All through the whole ride, he started talking about Smoking Joe Frazier. Can you whip me? He said, you whip me? So Joe, Smoking Joe Frazier. See, I wrote a poem. He said, Joe, come out smoking. I'll be poking on water on that smoking. He said, I might amaze you. I will be tired smoking Joe Frazier. All through the whole time in New York, Philadelphia to New York City, I had to go through that noise all the way.
What did you do?
So I had a chance. We got into New York City, 42nd.
He slapped me. And,
42nd and Broadway, and somebody messed around and saw him and myself, and he went off again. Smoking Joe Frazier, ladies and gentlemen, Smoking Joe Frazier, the man who got my title. I won my title. I was in the car.
Oh, Lord.
I said, look, I'll whoop this sucker right now. So after a while, he got back in the car and kind of cooled down some. I said, hey, man, cool it off. You know what I mean? So he said, a song. Start singing. It's not singing. Ladies and gentlemen, a great guy. I would say we love him. He's a fine champion.
Oh,
congratulations.
Thank you. Star Frazier. Thank you, guys.
Joe Frazier. I'll say one thing. I might see how you got the other people. How did you get Joe Frazier here? My man, Joe Frazier.
I want you to listen to this, Muhammad. As a boy, you worship one particular. I am, just about. But I want to remind you of one particular boxing hero who later in life you've got to know and who sadly cannot be here because, as you know, he recently underwent massive heart surgery, which has affected his powers of speech. But such is his high regard for you that here, in his home in Las Vegas, all the bravery that went into winning of those trophies went into this brief greeting to you.
Hello, Muhammad. When you were a little boy, you just watched me on television. Now I enjoy watching you on television. But I'm sorry I couldn't be with you.
The Brown Bomber himself, the great Joe Louis.
Muhammad, how are you doing?
Thank you, Joe Louis. A fighter still. And there, Muhammad Ali, we come to the end of our Christmas surprise package, except for one thing. Well, two, actually. With Veronica's consent, they're not, as you thought, tucked up in bed just yet. They're here with their nanny, your children, Hannah, age 2, and Layla, nearly 1. Well, to the greatest, I know they're the greatest. Muhammad Ali, 3 times heavyweight champion of the world. This is your life.
Thank you.